Okay, so let us start. So just to this presentation is coming, right? The sorting problem. It is
Yes,
coming.
sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just to recap, we have started with the sorting algorithm. We know the sorting problem is basically to arrange the number in a increasing order. So we have discussed one sorting algorithm in the last class, that is insertion sort. So in insertion sort, what we do, we have given an array of n numbers. This is the array of n numbers, and this we need to arrange in a increasing order in the same array. So that's why the insertion sort is in place sort. We are not taking any help of any extra array, or we are taking help of some extra variable like key I, j, but those are constant. Those are three only. Like, it's not order of n or something like that. Order we haven't defined yet. So that's why it is called in place sorting algorithm. So whatever we are doing in this array. So we are not taking any extra resource for that, extra array for doing that. So that's why it is called in place sorting algorithm. So what we are doing here, we just have a for loop, outer loop in J. So we are just placing this AJ in its correct position. And what is the loop invariant of this loop? Loop invariant is, we know this part is sorted. So we start J is equal to 2. For that, A1 is sorted, only one element. We know this part is sorted. We need to find the position of this. I request all of you to mute the mic unless you want to speak. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. So this AJ value, whatever value is there, we are storing in the key, and we need to find the position of this. So if the AJ is greater than this element, we are taking this element in AI, then we don't need to do anything. We can increase J by 1, that will be taken care by this. But if this is less than, then we have a problem. Then we have to keep on shifting to get the position of this key. Then noise is coming. So what I'm doing, I'm just there is some noise from somebody's computer, so I can mute you all, which I don't want to do. Anyway, now it's okay. Thank you very much. Okay, so that is the thing. So we had taken one example, and then we started thinking of what is the runtime or execution time of this code. Then we have discussed the execution time will obviously depend on the size of the input. So if input is large, then we need to have more time to execute the code, otherwise it is less time. So that's why we make the function, we parameterize the runtime by a function. This function we denote by tn. So tn is the runtime when you run the code for a input size n. We have n numbers to be sorted. Then we have discussed the it will depend on the pattern of the input, because if you see the code, we can easily see if the input is already sorted array, we don't know what will be the input. So we need to talk about for all possible inputs. So if there are n element, how many inputs will be there? Factorial n. So it is huge. So we have to talk about all possible inputs. So this is for this insertion sort code. If the input is sorted, then we have seen that we are going to do the less work, because we just need to do the one comparison with the previous one like this. So this way, just for if there are n elements, so n comparison are required basically. But the thing is, if it is reverse sorted, then we have a more work, because everybody has to come forward to the beginning of the array. Okay. Now, based on this, we have discussed three kinds of analysis. Some echo is coming from somebody's. I think I can unmute to all. When I ask the question, this will mute everyone. Okay, I'm muted. So when I ask the question, I will unmute you again. Thank you very much. Okay, so so basically we will do three types of analysis: worst case analysis, average case analysis, best case analysis. So worst case analysis means the maximum time our algorithm is taking for any input. So for our code, for insertion sort, we have seen the maximum time we will take if the input is reverse sorted. So for that we need to calculate what is the time, and that will give us the maximum time. So that is the worst case scenario for insertion sort. Okay. And the best case is the minimum time, like when insertion sort will give the minimum time or if the input is sorted, because that time we are doing the less work compared to any other input, any other type of input. And the average case is like sometimes or on an average or expected runtime. So that is the average case. Average case analysis usually we do for the randomized version of algorithm. So that we'll discuss. So we want to discuss this three types of analysis, and this is, we have, as we have mentioned, this worst case is the most usual case analysis we will do, because worst case is the guarantee, the maximum. I mean, if we say that my worst case runtime is in a suppose I tell that, okay, I have a piece of code and my worst case runtime is 10 seconds. So that means I know that for every possible input, it cannot go more than 10 seconds. So that is sort of guarantee. So that analysis we should usually do for any algorithm. And the best case is bogus or cheating, because it is good. Maybe your code is running, giving 2 microseconds for certain input. Maybe the input is sorted or partially sorted, something like that. So, but that is not for all input. So that is sort of cheating or bogus. So that's why we go for usually worst case analysis of any algorithm to give us a guarantee or the maximum time it is taking our algorithm. Okay, on top of this, suppose we are talking about worst case analysis of a code, suppose for insertion sort. Now question is, and we have fixed this thing, size of the input. Suppose we are sorting 1000 element and we are dealing with worst case, so that means our input is reverse sorted. We have a array of 1000 element which are reverse sorted. Now the question is, will the runtime depend on any other factor? That is the question. So the answer is yes. So runtime depend on the computer where we are running the code, because if we run this code, the insertion sort with 1000 of element and this thing, and input is reverse sorted. If we are running this code in our brand new laptop, or if we are running this code in our old Pentium 1 or some Pentium 1 processor in our old computer. So obviously this computer which is having good speed will take less time to execute the code. Now the question is, then how will compare two piece of code, which one is faster? Because we have seen that, we know this will depend on the processor speed. So if we have a very fast processor, then it will give us a very fast, it will give us a quick result. But if you have slow processor, then it may not give us a quick result. So then the question is, how will judge two piece of code? Any idea how will judge? Are you muted? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir. We can hear.
Can you just tell me, so in that case, how to judge two piece of code? Suppose two code came for a competition. So how to judge?
Sir, worst case.
Yeah, but if you run this code in the two different computer, suppose I am running my code in brand new computer and I asked to run your code in some old computer. So obviously your code will be taking more time. So we cannot come with some decision, no? That which one is faster. Even if we run with the same machine, suppose we have a computer, I am running my code in at the night time and it is very hot summer. And I am running your code in a very much in the 1 p.m. in the noon time, where the there are very much hot environment, and our computer is our CPU is little busy with the fanning business, so it will take more time than. So that's why it is very difficult to compare two pieces of code in the same environment in the machine dependent sense. So basically we need to get rid of from this machine dependencies. So we need to have a way, or we need to want to have a mechanism where this machine dependent factor should not bother us, because it's headache. Like how much careful you will be if to run, even if you run in the same time, maybe some other users are using that computer. So many factors will be there. So that's why this notation, this asymptotic notation was introduced. It's a very big idea to analyze any runtime of some piece of code. So the idea is basically we are going to ignore the machine dependence constant. For example, suppose I have a code, piece of code, where I have the runtime like this, 100 n square plus say 500 n plus 1000 seconds. 1000 seconds. Suppose I have a piece of code, and I have the loops, all the loops, and now I know the how much time it will take to execute the adder, multiplexer in my hardware. So based on that, I get this parameters, this 100, 500, 1000 seconds. So this is the exact runtime, say, and this n are coming because of that loop, and inside the loop we are doing something. For example, if you come back here in the insertion short code, just a minute. Yeah, so here if we have a loop over here, this loop is of size n sorry, and we are doing some work over here. So this is the assignment, and this is some checking, so the whether one is greater than other. So this checking, maybe we need to use the substitution addition, two's complement, then we can check this is also checking. So these are the time depends on the our hardware, our adder, our multiplexer, this is the assignment, our buses, all this will involve in that time. So that time, if we actually calculate, so based on that we have this so where is my runtime, so based on that time we got finally this many seconds. So our piece of code having this many seconds. Okay, but if you run this same code, this parameter will be less, because these parameters, these constants are coming basically from the time for the hardware business. So we want to get rid of this. So what we do in the asymptotic sense, we want to see the growth of this as intending to infinity when n is large, then only we can get rid of from the machine dependency. For that, what we do, very simple, we just drop all the lower order term. We cancel this term, we cancel this. This is the higher order term. And finally, we cancel the, and this is order of n square algorithm. This is order of n square algorithm. So this is the way we do the asymptotic analysis of any algorithm. So if you do that, then we can say this is the way we can get rid of. For example, suppose we have another code where we have the time complexity, say, n cube plus say 2 n square plus 3 n plus 5 second. this many seconds. We have another code which is giving this many seconds.
Sir, one doubt.
Yes, please.
What is n in time complexity function? Is it the number of iterations or the size
no,
of that?
N is coming from the loop. If you look at the code, n is coming from the loop. I mean, this is if we have a inside the loop, if we have another, suppose we have a loop of size n, and inside that, suppose we have another loop of size n, and inside that loop, we are doing some work. And that work is taking some time to do comparison, assigning. So that time we are just calculating. We are just measuring based on our hardware, and we finally get this time complex, this time exact, this is sort of exact time. So this is a T1 time for one piece of code, and this is a T2 time for another piece of code, another algorithm, another sorting algorithm, say. Now, why these coefficients are coming? These coefficients are coming less because maybe we are running this code in a brand new computer. Okay, or we are running this code when the computer is not busy with some other work, only concentrated on executing this code. So based on that, we got these parameters are less because of that speed of the computer or something. Now if we just take some values of n and if we just get the how much second it is taking, obviously this will be taking less second because this is having 100 and this is n square. So this is n into n square. So unless n is greater than 100, we'll get this more. But do you think this is a better algorithm, T1? No, na? T1 is...
Yes, sir, T1 is better.
Which one is better? T1 is better. But T2 is giving us less second when n is less.
But sir, with respect to n, the input size, T1 is growing slower than T2 because it is n cube.
Yeah, it is n cube. So that's why. Yeah, that's why we need to bring this notion up, because here also we'll do the same thing. We ignore all the leading coefficient. We ignore all the lower order term and we ignore that this is 1. So this is order of n cube algorithm, this is order of n square algorithm. So obviously order of n cube algorithm is, order of n square algorithm is better than order of n cube algorithm. So which one is better? T1 is better. You understand why we need to go for this this asymptotic analysis? Because to get rid of from the machine dependent constant, because it is very difficult not to run some code in a machine and then another code in a same machine and then get the exact time, how much it is taking. So that's why, sorry, we want to get rid of from this. So that's why we are doing this. So that is the idea. Idea is to do the asymptotic analysis. So basically we ignore all the machine dependent terms, constant, and we look at the growth of this time complexity when n is large. So it is n square algorithm, it is n cube algorithm. So obviously n square algorithm is better than n cube. We'll do the formal definition. Formally we'll define the order of this asymptotic notation of this. Okay. Any questions so far?
So example. The coefficients that are there for n square and n, these correspond to the reverse sorted array, right?
I am not asking this is the time complexity for our insertion sort code. I am telling we have two piece of code, maybe sorting algorithm or some other algorithm, some problem, and we got these two time complexity. This is algorithm one is having this time complexity, algorithm two is having this time complexity. I'm not telling this is our insertion sort code. Then we need to go inside. We'll do that. This is just an example. Suppose we have two piece of code, and these two piece of code, when we run in a physical machine, is giving us this is giving us this second, this is giving us this second. How we get this? We have some loop inside the code. In that loop, we are doing some work. So that work, how much time it will take, we are just calculating based on our computer speed. So that is giving us, this is the rough idea. I mean, this is not the, okay, yeah, then you can question, sir, how we measure that 100 second is coming or five. So this is just to understand you, this type of factor will be coming from the machine dependence thing. How much our machine is doing for all this job.
So how do we decide if an algorithm is of order 2 or order 3, like n square or n cube?
So that depends on how we'll see on how the expression is coming, the basically the loop, because if you come back to here, the insertion code, so here we have a outer loop of size n, and here we are doing some work. Here we are doing some work, so this work will take some second, right?
Yes, sir.
But here we are assuming this is taking order of one. We are assuming this is taking constant second. This is taking constant. We don't really care about how much second, whether 10 second, if computer is old computer, 100 second. We don't really bother about that. We are just taking these two work will be done in a constant time or theta we haven't defined yet, or order of one time.
Okay.
That is the idea, because we don't want to get into this machine dependence factor. We want to get rid of from there. So we don't really bother how much exact time will take to these two assignment.
Mm.
We think that these two are taking in constant time or theta of one time. Theta of one will define. And here we have another loop. So this loop will depend on the input pattern, how much it has to come, because every element has to come in its position. So depending on whether array is sorted or if it is reverse sorted, everybody has to come to the beginning of the array. So depending on the input, this loop will be taking size of n or n by 2 or order of I, something like that. We'll do this analysis. But again, these two checking, I greater than equal to 0 or not, these two checking again is constant time, we assume. We don't really care about how much exact time it is taking. Again, this will take constant time, this will take constant time. You understand this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now let us formally define three asymptotic notation which we'll use for the time complexity of our algorithms. So first notation we use is big O. Big O notation. We have three notation: big O, big omega, big theta. So first one is big O. So big O of G, see the just little bit of math is there, but it is not so tough to understand. I have examples also. So basically big O of some function, it could be n square, it could be n cube. Sorry. So when you say big O of Gn means this is the set of all function Fn such that Fn is bounded by Gn with some constant factor when n is large. That is the meaning basically. When n is large means n tending to infinity. We denote this by n is greater than, there exists some n0 such that for all n which is greater than n0, we have this bound. So basically, Fn is bounded above by Gn. So that is the definition of big O of Gn. So if it is big O of say n square, what is big O of n square? Big O of n square is the set of all function Fn such that Fn will be less than equal to Cn square for some C positive constant and some n0 should exist. So this is the definition. So this you have to understand. This is the definition of big O notation. So let us take an example. Suppose we have a Gn like this. This is our time complexity we get from some algorithm. And this we want to see whether this is big O of n square or not. So to be big O of n square, what we need to show? We need to show this Gn, this is our Gn. This Gn will be less than equal to some constant, this is our Fn. And Gn is n square. So we need to show this is less than equal to some C into n square. To show this, we do this exercise. So n is the number of input. So So n is obviously natural number. N start from 1, 2, 3 up to like this. So n is always positive integer. So n is the number of input. So n is always greater than or equal to 1. So this is less than or equal to 100 n square plus 20 n plus 5 n square, because n is greater than n square is n is greater than 1, so n square is greater than 1. So this term is always less than this term. So this is okay. If you have any doubt, please let me know. And then we just calculate this. So this is also less than n square. So this will be 20 n square. So if you add this up, we have 125 n square. So 125 n square means this is our c, and this n0 is 1, because this is true for all n greater than n0, because this is n square we have taken over with this. So this is c into n square. This is our c. So we have, from this definition, we can say this is a order of big of n square. Is this okay? Any question on this?
Sir,
hello. We can have gn equal to 125 n cube also.
Yeah, 125 n cube also. Even 125 n to the power 4 also. So if it is big of n square, that means it is big of n cube, any higher power. That is true. Correct.
Okay, sir.
It is big of n to the power 4, n to the power 20, anything. So yeah, that is correct. So if one algorithm is big of n square, that means it is big of n cube, big of n log n, n square log n. So any higher term, we can show. That is true. Yeah.
If we are asked to find big O of a given function, so there can be multiple answers. So which one to report? So
the best one, like this is order of n square. Now you can try to show whether this is big O of n or not, right? First of all, you can check this is big O of n cube, big O of n to the power 4, but you need to show the best one, tight bound, right?
Okay, we tend to report the tightest upper bound in this case.
I mean, tightest means obviously n square, it is also big O of n square, but we know the, it is also big O of n cube. We can prove that, because whatever is less than cn square, that is also less than cn cube, na? So that is the thing. So, but we need to see first if you go for the tighter, we need to show which, because n square is always better than n cube, that sense. Yeah, I got your question. You are telling that if you have given some function, you got some bound. Now we need to see whether you can get better bound on that. Like you need to, if we are getting n square bound or n log n bound, n square log n bound, then we can need to see whether we are getting n square bound or not. So we need to,
Sir, since we are not taking the coefficients, so how do we compare with the same big O notation, like n square, 2 n square?
No, suppose? They are same. If we have another algorithm which is having say 50 n square plus 10 n plus 1, so they are asymptotically, these two algorithms have same time complexity.
Okay, sir.
They are same.
Sir, can you explain this definition once more? We can do it there.
Yeah, sure. So this definition is this is the definition, like big O of gn. Gn could be n square, n cube, n log n, anything. So this is a general definition. So big O of gn means this is a set of all functions. This is a set of all functions fn which are bounded by gn with a constant factor. So that means we want to see the fn. Fn is our time complexity of our code. Now we want to see how the growth of fn, whether it is bounded by some known function gn or not. So if you take n square over here, instead of gn, so that will be n square. So this is nothing but just put gn is equal to n square. So this will be set of all function fn, set of all function fn such that we should have two, one constant c and another n0 such that this fn is bounded by, fn is bounded by c n square, because our gn is n square for all n like this. It could be n cube. So this is the definition of, general definition of this notation.
Sir, we are removing the 20n in the, that 125 n square plus 20n it should be. So
this is n square. This should be n square. This 20n square. This is 20n square because it is, if we take n greater than 1, so we are taking, so n square, n square, this is less than this, okay?
Okay, sir.
This is less than this because we are multiplying one n over here and that is greater than 1, so that has to be, so this guy is less than this guy. You can do this little math for these two examples. As an exercise, this you can show this is order of n algorithm, and this you can show order of n cube, even though we have a negative term over here. So I suggest you to do these two exercises, okay? So now we go for another notation, which is...
Excuse me, sir.
Please.
Sir, for big O, can we simply say that if we are given a function, then the highest degree of that function is the big O?
Yeah, that is the engineering sense. What I told that you just ignore all the lower order term. So we cancel this term because higher order term is n cube. So we ignore all lower order term, and then we got 100 n square. Then we ignore the leading coefficient. So this is basically order of n square algorithm. That's engineering sense. But since we have a proper definition, if you want to follow, so this is the definition of big O notation. Okay, so let us move to another notation, which is big omega. So big omega is like lower bound. I mean, we have seen big O, which is upper bound, and big omega is lower bound. So big omega of gn is set of all function such that fn will be greater than some c into gn for n is large. So you want to see, this is a lower bound. So our so if we want to define for say big omega of n square, big omega of n square, this is nothing but set of all function fn, our gn is n square, nothing else, such that we should have two parameter like n0 and c, such that this fn, this function, this time complexity will be greater than cn square. Cn square. This is the definition. Okay. So, so for example, if you take this function, see, this is our gn, fn. If you take this function, we want to see whether this is big omega of n cube or not. So for that, what we need to show? We need to show this must be greater than equal to some constant into n cube for some positive constant c and for the all n after some n zero. But that is the growth we want to see. Okay. So for that, we need to do a little exercise here. So let me check. So this is greater than this because we are, this is plus 5, we are ignoring that, so this must be greater than this. And this is greater than, because the n, after n is greater than 20, so this is greater than n cube, because this is minus term. So this is 2n cube, so for our n0 is 20 and c is 2. So this is big omega of n cube. Okay, we can do the similar exercise for this notation, these two. Okay, is this okay or any question on this? This is another definition of this asymptotic notation.
Sir, in this example, 3n cube minus 20n square plus 5, we see that big omega, the gn is coming n cube. And also, if we find out the big O of this, it will also come as n cube.
Yeah.
So the difference lies only in n naught.
Only n naught, yes. Yeah, you can take maximum of that too. Yeah, that is true. You can try that exercise. You can try to show this is also big omega, big O of n cube. So to combine these two, we have a definition that is called big theta, which is both upper and lower bound. Now the question is, these two notations, big O and big omega, big O and big omega. Now whichever usually we do for our algorithm, which notation we will use for our time complexity?
Big O.
Why?
Because it is giving the upper bound, that is the worst case.
No. Don't confuse with worst case and best case over here. Worst case is different and worst case is based on the pattern of the input. This is nothing to worst case, best case, and this thing nothing to do with this notation. We'll use this notation for all the cases. So this is nothing to do with this notation. Worst case is different. Worst case analysis is when we have, when our time complexity will be more for a particular input which is giving the more work. But the time complexity, if we want to quantify, we have to take help of this notation. So worst case is nothing to do with the big O. Or is this clear? Worst case, best case, average case, those are basically coming from the pattern of the input. Because for insertion sort, if the input is reverse sorted, we have a worst case. That means how much time the reverse sorted element, reverse sorted array will take, that is the maximum time. No other input will be crossing that time. Now, if we have to determine that time, then we have to take help of this type of notations. So, for worst case also, we'll do this big omega, big O. So, this is nothing to do with the type of analysis. This must be very clear. Usually, people get confused with this. Big O we usually do for O. No, nothing like that. So this is the notation will help us to analyze a piece of code. Okay. Now my question was different. My question is, suppose you have an option. You can go for big O notation or big omega notation. Now which notation you will prefer to use for your code?
Big O.
Big O. Why?
Sir, because the growth of the Fn will always be lesser than big O.
Yeah, big O is like if I say that my time complexity is big O of n square. So that means big O of n square means we know certainly it cannot go more than n square. It cannot go n square log n or something. So this is the upper bound. And if I say my time complexity is big omega of n square, that doesn't make any sense. Like for a vexen, I'm telling you, suppose I tell that, okay, I have a piece of code. It is taking it can take 500 second maximum, I mean upper bound. That has a meaning. But if I say, okay, my piece of code is lower bound is 100 second. Lower bound 100 second, but that doesn't give anything on the upper bound, right? So that's why we usually go for big O. But sometimes we need this notation big omega to see if our code can be less than that upper bound or not. So those things we will discuss slowly. Anyway, let us come to last notation. This is big theta. Big theta is basically the big O and big omega. So it's both. It's combination of both the upper and lower bound. So this part is big O, and if we take the lower bound, this part is big omega. So we have both the this is not looks like O. Anyway, so this part is big O. Okay. So if it is both side bounded, like bounded above, bounded below, then we say this is a big theta notation. So big theta of Gn is basically this is set of all function Fn such that we have two positive constants C1, C2, which is bounded by this Fn. Okay, is this clear? So if you have to show some function is big theta, then we need to show the both. For example, this function, you can take this as exercise. For example, this function, if you need to show that this is big theta of n cube, then you need to first show this is a big O of n cube, also big omega of n cube. So both separately. Then you can tell that this is big theta of n cube. Okay. Now, but if you don't like this math, then in engineering sense, what you do? You got this expression. You ignore all the lower order term. All the lower order term ignore. Then we ignore the leading coefficient. Then this is an order of n cube algorithm. Okay, that is the thing. And we have this two more exercises you need to do. Okay, now let us see.
Sir, I had a doubt.
Yeah.
The big omega notation could be n, and let's say the big O notation can be n cube. So like the big theta notation could be any of the n
cube. No. It has to be simultaneously both. It's not that if we what is your question? You are getting big O of
n cube.
N cube, and you are getting
big omega of n.
Big omega of n. No, you cannot say this is, what is your conclusion? You want to say this is big theta of, big omega, yeah, so big omega of, if it is greater than n, no, what is your question?
Yeah, so like in this, we can have big theta as n cube, n square or n, right?
No, you cannot conclude that. For big theta, you need to have both. This has to be n cube. If this is n cube, then only you can say this is big theta of n cube. But if you are separately having two different values, you cannot say so. So but my question is, if it is big omega of n, does it mean big omega of n cube? No. So then you cannot say so. Why no?
Because this is a lower bound, so.
This is a lower bound, yes. So anything lower than that, it is greater, yes, right. So you cannot say that. Even you cannot reduce this to order of n, because that may not possible. Okay. So in that case, you cannot conclude.
Theta is not defined.
Yeah, I mean your theta, you are not getting theta for big theta. Theta means big O, theta is not defined. If we have these two in your hand, you cannot say this is a big theta of n square, n cube or big theta of n. For big theta, you have this definition. For both sides, it has to be bounded. So for both sides, bounded means it has to be big O and it has to be big omega. Okay. Okay, so let us move to the we have mentioned why we need. Please.
Sir, can you go back to the previous slide?
Yeah. Yes, I'm here.
Yes, sir. So, sir, the term that for n greater than 20, sir, how did you get to that term, n greater than 20?
Previous slide means before that? This one?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir, the previous slide.
This one is having n greater than 20, right?
Oh yes, sir. Omega notation.
Are you seeing the slide?
No, sir.
Which slide is showing in your
Yes, sir. Now I can see.
Now tell me.
As soon as we have removed the constant from the right-hand side expression. Sir, and after the in the second step, you have written 3n cube minus n cube for n greater than 20.
Because this is 20, this we want to replace by n, right?
Yes,
because
sir.
If we want to replace this by n, but this value is 20, so that means this has to be greater, because this is negative, this has to be greater than the...
Okay.
Just think about it. This is 20, we are replacing this by n. And this is negative.
So this Yes, sir. Correct.
Okay. So this is the thing we want to see, that n square algorithm is better than n cube algorithm. We have already discussed this. Suppose we have two pieces of code. One is having this time complexity, and one is having this time complexity t2. And if you draw this code. Draw these two time complexities. So this was second say. These are coming from the machine dependence things. So if you draw this, then for n, here x-axis is n, and this is the time complexity, time. So then you'll see this curve. Now at some point of time, because this is more, this is 90, this is 2. So after some point of time, it will be showing that t2 is having less time. This is the y-axis is time, runtime. So this is, but if you see the growth of this curve, then after certain n0, we are getting this t1 is better. So that is the thing.
Sir, before n0,
before n0, t2 will be better. But we are not, we are doing this for, we want to see the growth, because that will... not mislead us, na? That will give us the things. Okay,
sir.
Now come
one more question.
Please.
Is it possible to have like a big O of n cube plus n square, or minus big O of minus n square, something like that?
No. If it is coming the expression like n cube plus n square, then we'll drop the n square, because n cube is the dominating term, na?
Okay. And so what about big O of minus?
You just think about if n is 1 lakh or 1 crore, then suppose you have a n cube plus n. So 1 crore cube is huge term compared to just n. So 1 crore will be dominating term, right?
Yes.
Is that your question? Like, so if you have an expression like big n cube, we'll go for this. Okay. So I want to show this. How much time is left?
We have class, sir.
Okay, then.
2 minutes, sir.
2 minutes? Okay, we should not go. Okay, so we stop here now. I'll just start from here. Okay, thank you very much. If you have any question in the next class also, you can ask before we start. Now you suggest me to stop the recording, right? Yeah, I stop the recording. Stop recording.